It's exciting to be here with you on day number 274. I'm Eric Rhodes, and my guest today is Vincent Crotty. Vincent, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, Eric.
Thank you for being on today. We wanted Vincent to be on because Christmas is a magical time, and Vincent is going to show you a form of magical painting I'm going to guarantee you've probably never seen in your life. And this is going to be exciting. And this is something, tell us a little bit about it, Vincent. What are you going to do?
So I'm going to do a painting of a daylight painting in Ireland, in County Clare. I'm going to change the lighting at the end, and it's going to turn into a nocturne.
Daylight painting and change the lighting and turn it into a nocturne just like that, right?
That's correct. I'm going to give this a try here. I'm going to paint a scene in, County Clare, a little town called, little village called Quilty in West Clare. It's a daytime scene, and by the end, it's going to be a nighttime scene. So that's hard to probably understand, but I'll do my best and give it a shot. I like to start with large brushes.
Wow.
So if the brush feels too big, it's the right size. So I'm going to take some Indian yellow and I'm going to slather it right over this blank canvas here. And I'm setting up the color of my light, which I'm going to call Indian yellow, which is a really strong, wonderful, transparent, rich, golden warm yellow. So I'm going to cover the whole canvas first.
And I'm going Are you painting in oil or acrylic?
I'm working in oils today.
Okay, you had to look.
I have worked with Cobra oils earlier, and water-based oils are wonderful. The fluorescent paints are water-based, so it's good to keep water-based with water-based. But I'm gonna just do this tonight because you know it's okay. It will work, but ideally, water-based belongs along with each other. So I'm going to take off the excess here with a paper towel. I don't want it completely dominating the sky. I do want some in there though. So I'm going to do this again. Now I'm going to get that a little lighter. And once again, I'm going to go back to my big brush. It is a big brush. But
are you using medium? What are you dipping into?
I'm dipping into Gamasil.
Okay.
And I have a little liquid here, which I don't really need, so I'm going to take that off. All right. So it is a big brush, but a big brush can make a small mark. See that?
Yep.
A small brush cannot make a big mark. So when I'm teaching, I try to get my students to get out of the comfort zone. I get comfortable with large brushes. I'm a product of trade school. So
where did you go to school?
I went to school in Cork City for sign painting and painting and decorating. And it was very strict. And I learned how to make stuff look like marble. I learned to draw all the alphabets. They were very much trying to train me to make a living when I left trade school. And they were very kind, but strict. But I thought it was almost better than what a lot of people experience in art college. So it was, they really helped me to survive well after I left school. And they gave me all sorts of practical advice with paint chemistry and that kind of stuff. So they were for a sign painter, the goal is to have the finish to be like glass. You want the paint to stand up to the elements outside. So they were very good at explaining paint chemistry and how.
Did you ever make a living as a sign painter?
I sure did. I was a sign painter very much like from the age of 22 to the age of 25. I was in a small town in Ireland, my hometown. And I painted signs there. Every time I put a sign up on a ladder with the drill gun, I'd get off that ladder. I'd have six more jobs. So I was in a small town, word travels very fast. So I was in demand. Everyone wanted to. Ireland is a very grey kind of a country, a lot of rain. So we tend to paint our buildings a little brighter to make up for the poor weather, lots of rain. So Ireland can be very colourful. The streetscapes are quite beautiful, really. And sign painting is it's a very old tradition in Ireland and England, I guess. Well, everywhere. But in Ireland, the guys that taught me would have been taught by guys that used to hand paint trains, believe it or not.
Hand painted what?
The trains, you know, railway cars.
Oh, really?
That was a lifetime job in the early and maybe in the 20th century in Ireland. Before spray painting came, hand painting of cars with oil paint. So those kind of guys were good at getting a good finish and applying paint in a way that looked very pleasing. So anyway, back to this scene here. I'm going to do what I can with this brush until my teeth hurt. I'm going to stay with this brush for as long as I can.
Okay. I'm going to write that down in the comments. Do what I can with this brush until my teeth hurt.
Well, it's a good discipline. You know, a lot of my students want to paint loose. If you want to paint loose, that's your best friend. I use a 4-inch brush in my classes for my 24 by 36.
And you're just using a brush you get at Home Depot?
Yes. And I sand the brush with rough sandpaper. This is a cheap brush. It's like 99 cents. So it's kind of a frustrating brush because the hairs fall out. But if you sand it with rough sandpaper, all those hairs that are going to fall out will fall out at the get-go. So it becomes a very good brush just after you sand it. So,
how did you learn that one?
Trade school.
Yeah, of course.
They were, very good. So, all right. I'm putting on my average sky here.
All right.
To me, average is a very important word. I'm going to get the average sky. And I'm absolutely not going to worry about the nuances or the subtle changes that are in the sky for now. I'm looking for simplicity here. And all I know is that the sky is going to be brighter than the water. So that's my average sky. I know the bottom of the sky is a little more peachy. So I'm going to get some tiny bit of orange here. And move along. So the beauty of the big brush is it prevents me from really getting into
detail,
small stuff. So
yeah, also you can get a lot done very fast.
Yes. So I spent a lot of time when I was a teenager, the local drama person was putting on kids performances, you know, on every Christmas. Babes in the Wood,
yeah,
Jack and the Beanstalk. So he used to give me free canvas, free paint, and I was free. It was a non-paying gig, but it was I was painting 25 foot canvases, 25 feet wide by 12 feet tall, many times, you know, three different scenes. And I got used to large scale stuff. And it was very, very good training. A lot of fun.
Sounds like it.
All right, so I'm going to put down my average water. It's going to be a little deeper than the sky.
But average.
Average. My favorite word for painting. All right. Going to leave that there. It's just the average water. Yes, it could get brighter. Yes, it could get darker. But on average, that shape is darker than that shape. So that's important. I've already ignored the photograph, and in some ways I've changed the road here. So this shape is going back into space a little bit. It's got to be slightly darker than that. So I'm just ballparking stuff. There we go. Now I'm going to ignore the scene even more. I'm going to ignore the photograph even more. I'm making a snow scene from us. This is a summer photograph. You're going to be confused here. I'm painting a summer snow scene, and it's a morning painting. It's the golden hour.
Golden hour. All right.
8 o'clock on a summer's evening in Ireland. But which is a beautiful, warm Indian yellow colored light. So I'm going to, I almost grabbed the other brush, but I'm not going to allow myself. So here we go. I'm going to mix the light hitting this cottage. It's an old stone little structure. A very simple Irish little building here. I'm going to just put that in. It would be nicer if I had a small brush, but I'm not allowing that to happen. So I'm going to keep going as far as I possibly can with the large brush. There's light hitting back here as well. I'm just going to get that in. There's a little light hitting the grass here. I'm using lots of Indian yellow. So there we have the big picture. No, it's warm light hitting here and here and back here. Warm light is always balanced with a cool shadow.
Okay.
I just noticed that I forgot to plug in my phone. So hang on. Excuse me. Bear with me.
Your battery's going to go low?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll just fill in here for just a second. Just let me show you a couple other things that Vincent has done. This is a cityscape that he's done, and he probably did that with a big brush, I'm just guessing. Look at that. Look at that beautiful light, very abstract shapes. Beach scene. There's a street scene. Could be Boston. A nocturne.
All right.
All right, you ready?
Yeah. By the way, Eric, that nocturne is that's under the influence of ultraviolet light.
Ah, okay. We're going to learn about that in a minute.
If you want to express the color blue, you can do it so much better with ultraviolet light. It's a whole other feeling. All right. A little clean up here. I'm going to divide the painting into warm light is always balanced with cool shadow. So the sun is the primary light source hitting all these surfaces. But the secondary light source is the blue sky. So that blue sky is illuminating the shadows. So I want to balance this painting with nice, cool. I'm going to take alizarin and cobalt, And I'm just going to throw this area here into deeper, cool shadow here. I'm going to put the rod, I'm going to cool that down in one fell swoop. All right. So I said earlier I was going to put some snow in here. It's we're anticipating harnessing the ultraviolet light.
Okay. So, you get a lot of snow in Ireland?
We don't. It's when we get snow in Ireland, everyone is jumping for joy. Sometimes it might take 2 or 3 years before the next snowfall happens. And when it does, it doesn't last for long. Because Ireland is, the Gulf Stream keeps Ireland not too, it doesn't ever get too cold. Not like here in Boston. All right. I mixed some blue with that. Wait, this is snow and shadow here. I'm going to be very rough and just keeping large, staying large as much as I can. All right, I've got to clean up my mixing area. A couple of seconds here.
Okay, terrific. If you're just tuning in, our guest is Vincent Crotty, who's in Boston, but from Ireland. And Vincent is going to demonstrate a technique, once he gets this further along, how he's going to convert this daytime painting to a nocturne painting with a click of a switch. So you want to hang for that. It's going to be a very, very Christmassy feeling. I'm anxious to see how he does it.
You want to hear about how it came about, Eric?
Yes.
All right. So my wife is an Irish dancer and a modern dancer and a choreographer. So she had this job at a Boston production called The Christmas Celtic Sojourn. And last year, it's a very elaborate production that goes on in a huge theater downtown. Beautiful old Victorian theater. So last year they asked me to be a set painter. So I wanted to do a nocturne and they wanted broad daylight. So I said, gee, wouldn't it be great if it could be both? And I didn't know what would happen. And so they all came to my studio, and just before they showed up, I took this small little painting and I added some fluorescent touches, and lo and behold, it turned into a nocturne. So the lighting guy got really excited. I got really excited. We all did. There was four people. There was an artistic director and the lighting guy and Eric Levinson, the stage design guy. So it was an experiment, a huge experiment. So they digitally printed my painting at 40 feet wide by 20 feet tall.
Oh, so you didn't have to paint it that size. They printed it. That's wonderful.
Yeah, I could have painted it, but they were like, well, save your energy for the ultraviolet work.
Which you had to put on by hand.
Yeah, you can't print with fluorescent paint. So so anyway, we put it on the stage, and the lighting guy used huge banks of ultraviolet light. I hate to say it, but it was magical. It was absolutely shocking to see it on such a grand scale. And then, as the music changed, he was able to move into all sorts of different moods. And basically, he was able to go from early morning to mid-afternoon, late evening, all the moods, and the dark of night, with one scene.
Hmm.
So that was that.
And that was a matter of adjusting the level of the ultraviolet light.
Yes, yes. And adding in warm lights and different. I mean, he came to my studio for 6 or 7 different nights. And we just, we played. Because he was, he didn't know what the hell I was doing, and I didn't know what the hell he was doing. So we had to communicate. And so anyway, that was last Christmas last year. I'm putting in a smaller little dark bank of clouds here with a little pale purple. I'm going to try to stay fairly quick and simple. At the base of the sky, there's a little darker cloud activity there. All right, I am now going to mix snow and sunshine. Here we have an area of shadow. Now I'm going to mix white with lemon. I'm going to just make it as though there was a little snow and a little grass showing through the snow. Just going to get that on there and not get too fussy. Going to put smaller maps back there. They could be houses, they could be anything. All right.
The anticipation is tough.
What's that?
I said the anticipation is difficult.
Difficult because I'm walking between two different things. All right. That's light hitting there. It's a little stronger there, a little more there. There. All right. One more thing before I move to fluorescent paint and just put some light in these distant clouds, base of the sky. All right. So that's the sky with no moon or no sun or nothing. It's that's the golden hour hitting a snow scene.
Okay.
All right. Now I'm going to turn on my
your ultraviolet light.
Ultraviolet light.
So you, when you paint this, you have to paint with the light on.
I don't have to.
But yeah. Now, are you're going to be painting wet ultraviolet paint into wet oil paint?
Yes.
Not a problem.
It might be a problem, but it's, I'm not going to worry about it tonight, Eric. I'm more used to oil paints.
Yeah.
But I could have done Cobra water-based oils.
Yeah.
And I did earlier on a different scene. How much time do I have?
Oh, you've got about 20 minutes.
All right.
And plenty of time.
Okay. Let me grab a little extension cord because I needed the
You needed it for your cell phone.
For my phone, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Hang on a second.
All right. Okay, so that's a fluorescent tube. Where do you get something like that?
Oh, on Amazon, you can get that in, definitely on Amazon. Or
so you can paint little secrets into your paintings, and then people never know they're there, but if they ever get ultraviolet light, they will show up, right?
Yes. Yes. All right. So
okay.
I'm going to jump into the fun stuff here.
Okay. Well, this has been pretty fun so far.
Let me put a light on in the cottage, okay?
Okay.
Now, I don't know if this, can you see that?
Yes.
Okay, that looks like a light, bright light. Can you see that?
Yeah.
So this paint glows. This is lemon yellow.
But it just looks like oil paint.
Yeah, it's I have done it on oil paints before. This is a more like a yellow medium colored light. So now we have lights reflecting in the water. I'm gonna slather some of that here. That warm yellow orange warmth up here. I'm going to mix that into the sky. Now, I'll dim the lights later on, and this will become more apparent.
Okay.
But for now, I'm inventing. Now,
if that fluorescent light were not on, would you be able to see any of that at all?
Tell you in a sec.
Yes. Okay. You still can. All right.
All right. It stays glowing for a little while after you take it away. Somehow. I don't know how that.
But it absorbs the light.
Yeah. All right. That's lemon yellow medium. Here's fluorescent white. It's going to invent the moon here. So there's a moonlight. That. I'm going to reflect that down here on the water. That moon, I'm going to invent clouds here now. The beauty of fluorescent paint, believe it or not, it's invisible. So I'm going to invent clouds here.
Okay.
So my daylight painting is going to still look like a daylight painting in daylight. But by night, we're going to have cloud activity here. I'm just putting some.
So that's not going to show up once the ultraviolet's gone.
And it'll be pretty much invisible.
I think we're all going to be going on Amazon buying ultraviolet paint.
Ultraviolet light, fluorescent paint.
Fluorescent paint.
Yeah. And it comes in every color of the rainbow. I'm going to show you some blues now. This is a pale blue. I'm going to introduce that into this water. It's an electric, glowing blue. And it might be a little over the top here, but that's okay. I don't worry about that. It's, let's say the snow here and shadow could take on some of that blueness. So I'm going to distribute some cool blueness around here. Let's take an opposite color as yellow light. So the opposite of yellow is purple. Let's add some purple to the sky. Here's a nice magenta. I don't know what it's going to do, but we'll find out. That's a little extreme. So I'll mesh it in with a large brush. Just see what happens. Let's take some red orange. Get a different light, maybe. There. And, you know, I could keep. In the example of last year when I was doing that large canvas, I was applying fluorescent paint for 5 nights.
Oh my.
And one night in the theater then, when the backdrop, I had one night before rehearsal where I could go wild and bring it a little bit forward.
Touch it up a little bit, yeah.
Yeah. All right, so that. I'm going to cross my studio and I'm going to dim the light and you'll see it maybe in a few different ways. Okay. And I'll come back. Give me one second.
This is exciting. It's kind of fun to see.
Can you see that?
Oh, wow. Look at that. Ah, wow. It's really amazing how the dimming changes the, it really gets eerie looking that way. And yet none of those marks are going to show up in non-fluorescent.
Yeah. So, I'll show you the, how much time have we, Eric?
You got plenty of time.
All right.
Take what you need.
I could bring this forward and I would, and I should and all that, but I'm going to take this down. I'm going to show you the finished one I did last year because there was more time put into this, obviously. I don't know what you can see of this, but
oh, that's beautiful.
It's more refined, okay?
Yeah.
Now in the theater, the one was way more refined. The clouds were, you know, finessed.
Yeah.
And
well, I want everybody to see that. Put it in front of the light so we can see it without the light influence on it.
Okay. So it's let me get this out.
Okay. So it looks like a pretty regular painting to me.
Yeah.
Now put the light on it in this light. Now, can you do the dimming thing for us again?
I gotta make sure this stays up here. Now, one second. Yep, hang on. Give me a second here. It's kind of precarious. Give me a second. I'm gonna go across the studio again.
Okay.
Do the light show.
Really fun, really interesting. Wow, look at that. Wow, that, whoa.
Right?
Van Gogh. Huh, fascinating. So you really got to put it where there are light sources.
Okay. So I was hoping to change the flavor a little, slightly bit. Earlier this year, I did a painting of a blacksmith.
Right.
In a forge.
Okay.
So today with Cobra water-based oil paints, which I got from Kyle Richardson, they're fabulous. I haven't worked on it with the fluorescent because I wanted to surprise myself too. Because I love the surprise. Here we go. You see that?
Yes.
It's rough, okay? It's no one's going to be begging me for this one, but it's an opportunity.
That's pretty good.
It's an opportunity to talk about flames. Different, you know, obviously. Here's red orange. What's that going to do to this painting? Can you see that?
Yeah, uh-huh.
So that light from the fire, is it possible that that light reached this guy's nose? Or his chin? Or the tip of his hat? Of course it is. Those surfaces are facing. And now this is rough. This is rough. But do you understand where I'm going? It's like, of course it hit his hand. He's in a forge. He's making, these are sparks. Red, orange. So it's a
fascinating.
It's a wonderful way of expressing fire too.
You better watch it. Kyle will start selling fluorescent paints soon.
So it's exciting, you know. I've tried experiments. I experiment a lot with it actually. I've tried to make stained glass windows. It works like a dream. I've tried painting on silver leaf. That works like a dream. So that's, if we go back to the idea of warm light, cool shadow, let's see what, this might look a little cheesy, but let's say there was cool light coming in from the window. You know, it's pushing reality.
Yeah. Well, and the key is being real subtle about it, not, you know, not putting too much out there.
Yeah. So I'm distributing some cool blue color notes here into a kind of, it's a blue and orange color harmony really with lots of black because it's a forge. And then another thing I was playing with was the lunar corona. I saw George Carlson talking about the lunar corona on the plein air convention, the kind of like the evidence of the rainbow.
Right.
Rings of the rainbow kind of forming around the moon. And fluorescent paint can mimic that in a quite impressive way. You know, you can really make stuff feel quite magical, you know. And so let me get this painting here, it's a dark, smaller painting.
Okay. You guys having fun? This is fun for me.
Here's a dark Irish landscape, right?
All right.
It's small. I hope it's not too small.
Nope, we can see it.
I just want to give you the flavor of the lunar corona. Okay, so here's fluorescent white now is going to. See that? Is that?
Yeah.
Is that visible? All right. There's the moon, and beneath it, obviously, the most shiny part of the water is going to be here. Is it possible that the light from that moon affected clouds around here? Of course it is. So I'm going to do that. These edges are too sharp, so I'll soften them with. I'm just starting the process here. That's white fluorescent paint. Looks kind of pale bluish, but it glows. But I'm going to do that. I'm going to try to get the feeling of nighttime on the ocean.
I think we need a Santa Claus painting with a red nose, a glowing red nose, man.
That's not a bad idea. All right. Yeah, you can do all sorts of magical things. So here we go. See that? It's just changing. Yeah. So it's... I teach in Newton at the New Art Center. And I'm always trying to incorporate the rainbow into my landscapes, even though I don't understand it, the science of it or anything. I'm fascinated by red, orange, yellow, green, blue, violet.
So how, if you're selling these, you tell people where to get a light, and you put basically instead of a light in a frame, a light over a frame, you just get a fluorescent light.
Yeah, I've anyone that I've sold, I haven't sold very few people this, but anyone I have sold a painting to, I have given them the light. And it's they can have their morning painting, they can have their bright painting, but after dark, if they want, they can turn it into a
I love it,
a nocturne. So it's very exciting.
It's really been a lot of fun.
So thank you, Eric, I really appreciate it.
Well, why don't you come back on screen, and then we'll say a proper goodbye.
All right.
All right. Well, wasn't that fun? That was really terrific. It's not something you see every day. And remember, it can't be seen by the human eye when the incandescent or when the fluorescent light is not on there. So it's kind of all a big surprise. So, Vincent, your website is vincentcrotty.com.
Yeah.
Right? And tell us where you're teaching again.
I'm teaching at the New Art Center in Newton, Massachusetts, just outside of Boston.
Okay, excellent. Well, thank you for being a special guest on Christmas Eve today. That's really special and very magical. Those are very Christmas Eve kind of scenes. You know, that could have been a full moon on Christmas Eve. And, you imagine people inside the houses of Ireland with the lights on, and who knows what's going on in there, having Christmas dinner.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you for being on today, Vincent.